try to get the attention of everybody. I will start with a very easy question. Who is interested in cryptocurrencies? So there's nobody else, just in the wrong room. Okay. Second one is, who owns cryptocurrency already in a small proportion? All right, that's good. So what we're trying to do today is that we want to give you an idea of a cryptocurrency survival kit. And if you own cryptocurrency, you already know that your view of information security has changed dramatically, and if not, it will after tonight. Because there are many pitfalls in this ecosystem of cryptocurrencies. Some practical information that I forgot to say is my access line. I know that above the how do you call this? The door openings. But it's basically the same way out as you got in. And the toilets are left and right. There's another thing, we have a Dr. Jumla in the room. He's now, I think he's rehearsing or
when
okay. It's Dr. Jumla, okay. That was the idea where it came from. We have a Dr. Blockchain in the room, and you will see there's a gear on this around him, and you can ask him questions, personal questions. So if you might end up with a whole pile of illegal money, for example, and you want to transfer that to cryptocurrency, it might be better to ask him and not ask him in the room. But any question you feel insecure to ask here, you can ask him personal things. All right. So the Bitcoin owners, they have a certain reason why they have Bitcoin, and the people that are interested in Bitcoin have also a certain reason why they are interested in Bitcoin. And I want to know these reasons of you. So who is has some feeling of missing out if you don't look into the subject of Bitcoin? We call it the fear of missing out. That's a very important reason why people buy Bitcoin. It's not an illness, it's just a normal thing. And who would want to own cryptocurrency or does actually own cryptocurrency? We had that question already, sorry. But thanks anyway. To transfer value, like money, if you want to pay with it or receive. Okay, that's still fair. Before we can continue with the why of all the survival kit, that you really get the feeling of why it is important that you look after your keys and your money and your value in the future. We have to look at cryptocurrency, what it is.
Hello.
So if you open the Bitcoin, Bitcoin was the first cryptocurrency around. You might know that. If you open that Bitcoin, like it would be the hood of it. Take out the blockchain. You can use the blockchain for several stuff, which we don't discuss tonight. We are not going into the subject of blockchain. You can visit any other meetup we do here in the A Lab. And mostly they handle blockchain applications in various parts of the public good. But tonight we're just focusing on cryptocurrency and its survival. The survival kit is focused on the key management. What we want to give you tonight is that you go back and you write down for yourself all the tips you hear and remember them tomorrow morning. Because tomorrow morning, if you write down your email address for us, or we will publish it in the permissionless society as well. You can compare your own list that we wrote down with the list that we provide. And exactly that is your personal cryptocurrency survival kit, because there is not one personal survival kit that we can present tonight, but it's your own survival kit that does the job. And what we want you to do then is that you start using cryptocurrency. So it's interesting to have this fear of missing out and to cover that a bit and buy some cryptocurrency. But it would be, for us, it would be much more interesting if you really start using them. Because if you start using them, what happens next is that you become more proficient in using them. And you know more pitfalls using them. You might lose some money on it as well, if you're not too careful. But we have several tips around to not have you lose your money. Right? But that's what we really want to do tonight, that you make your own personal survival kit if you have them tomorrow morning. So the definitions of cryptocurrency, I mean the characteristics of cryptocurrency, is that it's a total decentralized system. That's a technical view on the subject. So decentralized systems means that we have a lot of computers worldwide. It's a worldwide thing. It's not attached to boundaries of a country. So you have this group of computers worldwide. For Bitcoin, it's around 7,000 nodes, we call them. And they keep each other informed, and they decide on the validity of the ledger. And the ledger keeps track of the currencies, keeps track of the value that is in the Bitcoin, in this example. Right, so then we have the technical part here, we have the business part. If we have some sort of currency or a system, we would like to use that so we can transfer value from A to B. And we can transfer that between people, but also between people and machines. And we have also the possibility to transfer between machines and machines, which makes cryptocurrency very practical for IoT, Internet of Things as well. So then we have the last part, and because we have quite a few people here that actually own Bitcoin, I won't go into much detail, but the legal part of a Bitcoin cryptocurrency is that you can actually trust it. There's found out ways to validate a transaction which we have business wise with this whole technical network over there that keeps it technically valid. We can trust the fact that I sent my money from A to B and that I can't double spend it, for example. Okay, please enter the room. We've already started. We're now at the definition. Are you listening or just sitting?
Yes, now I'm listening. Yes. Yes. Thank you.
I could wait a bit. But we're in the process of defining the characteristics of Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies. And especially, I want to conclude, we have three parts, the technical part, the business part, and the legal part. And in the legal part, we want to conclude that you can actually see cryptocurrency as an improved way of handling money worldwide. So, next step, how does it work, and why should I care about how it works, and what are the pitfalls I could fall into? There are no bitcoins, there are no addresses, they don't exist. An account doesn't exist in Bitcoin. There's no balance either. It makes it easy, doesn't it? So all the perceptions that we had before in banks, they just don't exist. What does exist is the network which you can transfer and trust and transfer. So the transaction is the main part in a Bitcoin network. All the other things are aggregations above transaction. So if we start looking into the transaction, that will do the job, right? Agreed? If somebody doesn't agree and says, no, no, this is more important, that's more important, then feel free to react. I would like some reaction from the audience, so I'll start with something else. We'll park this. We're going to look at the transaction a bit later, all right? So I want to hear from you, what are some sort of prejudice against cryptocurrency? Could you shout them? Prejudice.
Used by criminals.
Sorry?
Used by criminals.
Criminals, there we go. Used by criminals. Criminals. Right.
So not necessarily as in our own opinion, just general.
Yeah, prejudice. I mean, things that are being said in the media that aren't necessarily true.
Right.
Can't
trust Satoshi Nakamoto.
You can't trust him? Or
no, you can't trust him. You can't trust the one who owns Bitcoin.
Okay.
You know that company that created it.
Don't trust the inventor. What have we got more?
It's anonymous.
It's anonymous?
Yes.
Oh, very good one. That's also always a very difficult one. So I'll write this.
Tax evasion?
Is it that?
With an E, add an E at the end.
Sorry?
Okay, we have a
second. Any more prejudice?
Used for tax evasion?
Sorry?
Used for tax evasion?
Oh, tax evasion, yeah. Well, that's actually
right.
True.
Yeah.
But that's actually true.
That's still <the difference.
laughs> We can't go into that. I want to take that off right away because we can't go into detail on that. It's I think we need a total new definition of invasion. Because we had the fiat over here, the Dutch tax authority that controls whether you you do illegal things with your money. And we asked them two questions. The first one is, could somebody prove that he's the only owner of a private key? That was the first question. The second question was, could I ever prove that I've lost my key? So they need some time in the, I think, 5-10 years to answer those two questions. So in the meanwhile, this definition of tax evasion is bloated, or how do you say that? Not very clear. You can help me with any English words because we don't have too many English words in the room, but help me out if you feel me. Any more? So think of that one.
It's a Ponzi scheme.
Sorry?
Ponzi scheme. It's a Ponzi scheme.
Ponzi scheme. Yeah, I'm deaf as well, so all my all my problems appear here. Ponzi scheme. And that's it. Who knows what a Ponzi scheme is?
Yeah,
how many people?
Okay.
Ketting life. It means that people get rich by stealing from other people. Any more? Oh yeah, Richard.
For example, if I want to transfer some cryptocurrency to me, then it's not
it's a feature of the cryptocurrency and public cryptocurrency world. So I would say that's a prejudice, is that right?
It's considered by some people.
Regulation. They skip central transactions. So, who wants one? Yeah. Okay. Now we're going to make the three of us. We're going to make a public key of Bitcoin. So please open the package. Please be careful, because people might be watching, and it's your public key. So what do you see if you open it up? Could you describe what you see?
Lots of houses.
It's a big bag. Okay, so you can put anything of value, money, in here, and you can take it out here. Well, suppose this would be our key. So what we did by unpacking it is that we have to make your own key. You do this on the internet for the Bitcoin. So you go, for example, to bitcoin.org, or you use a so-called wallet. But to be honest with you, right away, the wallet doesn't exist. Right? It doesn't hold money. It holds keys, which we will go into a bit further. But if you make a public address where you can receive money in, that's note that you get your private key. Right? And you have to be very careful with your private key. That's why we're here. It starts, as soon as you make it, you could say, is it safe to do that on the internet? It might be safe if it's not, if you don't receive a lot of money here. You could say, well, if I lose it, it doesn't matter. But if you convert a lot of money, which Aaron will go into, as a second speaker, then you want to be very careful. What happens if I put this here, you put it over there, and I want to transfer money from A to B? What happens is that, I hope I get it back from you. I won't give you too much. He's trying to get it in.
Too much money.
Exactly, what he does now is that he opens the key lock. And, normally, you put it always through the piggy bank, smaller device. What a Bitcoin transaction does, I could explain it to you in technical details, but I will just show you how it happens. There are cameras everywhere here, right? So, suppose that's the case, and I come in, but I don't come in. I think you should come in. I come in as being you, because you have the most money on your public address there. I come in as you, and I don't show up as you. Totally come. I walk over to your piggy bank. I take it out. So you take it out. And I put it back in my piggy bank, if you don't mind. There you go. But I'm still covered. That's the piggy bank. I put it in my own piggy bank, was, I tried to cover myself up a bit, but as I walk out, you see my silly walk, because I've been doing a lot of sports, and the way I walk, you can see that, you can't see my face. So I walk out. But we call that pseudonymity, because in the end, you will find out it was me that walked in the room, that used this private key to unlock the public key that we knew that was his, but I unlocked it. I took it, I walked here, and put it in my bank. You don't know whether I have the key of this finger, don't I? You can't prove that there's more people that could have this key of that finger. You can't prove that he got his own key from that finger. And these are all characteristics of cryptocurrencies that we are not used to. Because if we had a problem with our bank account, we phone the bank, and they will solve it out. But that's the main part of transactions that I want to show to you. That's the pseudonymity. It's not anonymous. Take that off. It's only used by criminals. That's if we would have criminals in here, or people that want to do something with illegal money, I would not advise them to use the Bitcoin, because it's not anonymous at all. They will find you right away, because they know exactly, I call that my silly walk. They need some time to figure it out, but in the end, I see people objecting a bit. Okay, we'll give you the opportunity to react. So in the end, there are services that can find out who's behind a public key in Bitcoin. There are several other cryptocurrencies that have more protection against against anonymity. But in the end, you will have to on-ramp and off-ramp. So you have to get into it and out of it. So you can own a lot of Dash or Monero or Zcash, but how can you buy cash from them? Okay? So this is, criminals are not very safe. Please, I saw your eyes. Could you tell what your eyes say?
First of all, we can't tell whether criminals are or aren't using it. There are silly or stupid criminals who do use it.
Yeah.
What is probably a fact, and also has been researched as far as I know, is that the amount of legal transactions is relatively increasing percentage-wise.
Yeah.
So the amount of crime use is definitely on the decline.
Yeah.
But we can't say that it's not used for criminals.
No, it's true. I think it's irrelevant. Yeah. That's why I take it off.
Criminals use everything, so.
Yeah. Yeah, and we'll use any innovation. They even
roads as well.
Yeah. They will use any winning innovation. Like they've probably used cars over horses to get away.
Probably. So
thank you, buddy. Yeah.
So you're sorry to result what happens when you steal from another wallet.
Yeah.
And you're also told that that in the end those transactions can be retraced. Right?
I don't get that. Sorry.
In the end, it's possible to retrace those transactions here.
Address wise.
Yeah.
So the pseudonym's name or address you use, you can always trace. But you don't necessarily know who's behind it.
Exactly.
But that is getting, okay, we'll come back on that as well. It's the verifications you have, it's getting harder to hide your identity. Yes. But you always leave traces when you steal. Hard to pinpoint to someone.
Thank you for answering the question here. We've got this one, I want to combine these two. Because if you don't trust the inventor, you don't trust the protocol. We, as cryptocurrency owners, or if we are interested in it, you should just step in if you trust cryptography and if you trust the whole protocol behind it, and also the governance behind it.
Right? If you don't, sorry, for a Ponzi scheme, there's one argument why it's not valid.
Exactly.
Because a Ponzi scheme lives from, let's say, indefinite supply. You need more and more users. Well, Bitcoin is capped. you have a maximum amount of Bitcoin. So from a theoretical point of view, can never be a Ponzi scheme, right?
Okay. It's
kind of
very slow.
Yeah.
We have this one. The skip central control checkpoint, that's what they do.
Yeah.
And that's a feature. That's a feature. So you can also, you can build in, we do on a daily basis. If you go to an exchange, you build in another central point of control. In fact, you deliver your key to somebody else. And what that means, we'll go into that deep.
Well, the question has something.
Yeah.
The question is, can Bitcoin be stolen as long as it's not legally recognized as a currency? Because it's only, you're only in the ownership of the keys.
Yeah.
And who is in the ownership of the key has access to the value. So if I'm having the ownership, or if I have the key that I'm not supposed to have, I have access, therefore I legally can't steal it because I do have the access, right? So can Bitcoin be stolen?
There's many near philosophical questions around this.
Yeah.
And they're all newly introduced by the fact that this technology emerged. So we have a lot of laws around Bitcoin that all say, well, we are applicable on Bitcoin, but we don't have sophisticated, to the point, laws focused on cryptocurrencies yet. But we think that they will be there.
You stole the key, of course, and I think it's the same as stealing a vault, because then the same story applies when you ski.
Then maybe we can take off the last prejudgment that it's a mathematically secured system.
Yeah.
Because it's obviously not mathematically secured if we have a superior system where the stealing of the key is getting punished.
Yeah. So we should be careful about discussing this too deep, because we could do that for the next few hours and continue tomorrow. The most important thing is that we should be thinking about is, at least tonight, this topic. Please come in if you like. We just started a bit already. The most important part is, how can I, or myself, improve my key management and be more secure? What is my survival kit in this whole system?
You have to cost you an incident, like the 49.
Depends on all of you.
Okay, so we have this whole area of key management. It's not only Bitcoin. We've got several other coins. We've got several other topics that are secured the same way as Bitcoin is, and that is the public-private key pair. Even our nuclear weapons are secured by ranges of public-private key pairs, and if they are cracked in the future, which is one of the prejudices we normally get down on as well, is that we have quantum computers, and they will break it. Yeah, if they break it, we will have nuclear warfare raining down our heads as well. So that will be the least of our problems as soon as we get that. So we have this key management, which is a very broad field of operation. And we are in there trying to manage our keys. And that key management is some balance between ease of use, user interfaces on the web, and security. So we try to balance them all the time. But what we've not seen yet is that, in fact, any Bitcoin, any value stored on the internet, that's me and it's you. It's not money, it's an identity. Your public key, and take care of that really closely, because it's a very important part for the rest of this meetup, is that you should be aware that a public key, that's me. How was that in the past? In the past, when it was me, I was living somewhere in a hut, and I had a few cows and a few chickens, and everything that went through me, or value transferred, went through me. I knew of it. and I acted with that. Now we are in the internet age, as this is now, and me is owned by many companies, especially not by me. My virtual identity is everywhere around, it's scattered around the place. And in fact, all the people combined, all the businesses combined in the world, which we call big data nowadays, they know more of me than I know. And there are many, many false information parts in that. So what would we like to have in the future, that's a me that I control it. So I don't want these people over there controlling my identity, I want to control it myself. We call that self-sovereign identity. And how can we do that? We can do that by knowing our own private keys. And me, and only me, needs to know the private key. And that's the real difficult part. Because that gives me an enormous amount of responsibility as well. Because I'm a human being. I'm very bad at keeping keys. Yeah. I lose them all the time. In fact, when I go home, I do like this. And then the next day, I don't know where my keys are. And then somebody else has to tell me that the keys are over there. Two problems. The first one is, I lost my keys. The second one is, somebody else found them and tells me where they are. If that would happen with your crypto value, it would be lost right away. And not because somebody would steal it at that moment. No, you would be lost because they could steal it any time, any point in the future. Right. So, I went emotional there. This is the future. I'm self-sovereign. I have this enormous responsibility to keep my keys because I don't want that anymore. I don't want control of my valuables, including my identity, my order. And I can't go back to ancient times. So it's about me. And the key, the keys I control it with, we have several means already. Can I ask a few questions to the audience? Who owns a cold store at the moment? A cold store like Trezor, Ledger Nano, or KeepKey? That's my first tip, buy one. If you want to own and keep cryptocurrency, and I saw less fingers that with the question that where I asked, do you own cryptocurrency? So all these people, please buy a cold store. Because anything that's connected with the internet or managed by the internet is not safe. Because somebody can find your keys over there. And they might use it. Which has been done, for example, with the great robbery at Mt. Gox. An example of losing keys is a person that had keys on his hard drive. And he lost the hard drive. And he didn't have a backup. So that's my second tip, please back up frequently, but keep your backup safe as well. If you have a cold store, somebody has a cold store, you said it's a cold store. So I don't know where you keep it, but what I want to know is how relevant is it that you keep it somewhere safe? What do you think?
Yes. It's of course safe because a roommate can just come in and grab a hard disk and or something like that, or
the cold store.
In case my computer.
They could grab the cold store. Is that important? Who else can say? Is there any clue? Yeah.
Well, it's not too important.
Why not?
Because
it's not too important, he says. Yeah.
Well, it's still secured with an amount of safe words and needs to be activated to be secure. So just plugging it into a device does not allow you to get access.
So what this gentleman here says is that the cold store is secured by some sentence of words. We call it a seed. And the seed is in fact the most important part. To be honest, if you have a key or a stamp a few times on it until it's totally broken, it doesn't matter. The most important part is the seed. Because if you don't store that well enough, somebody could find the seed, could steal it. No, they could be far more intelligent. You could just make a photograph of it, put it back where it was, or even don't touch it. Walk away with your seed and just wait until enough value arrives on the wallet that you can, that contains value. Is everybody still with me?
Well, the missing part is that then the intelligent person who took the picture has to walk into a shop, buy the same device, use the seed, and then steal your
second. That's exactly what happens. This gentleman over there tried to get you with us again.
Yeah.
What happens is, as soon as you back up your cold store, which is good practice, the advice, but if you would then not keep it safe or not be able to keep it safe, the seed, it's a 24-word sentence. And don't ask me how it works. I know how it works, but I can't explain it in 5 minutes. It's cryptography, but it can rebuild your total wallet. The wallet doesn't contain money, it contains keys. Yeah? It only contains keys. And the keys are your access to your public keys. That's where the value is. That's where the transparent house is. It has an address, but you need a key to enter. These keys are stored in the wallet. And the wallet has to be backed up. And the backup is a seed. And the seed has to be preserved well. You see all these responsibilities we get when we buy a Bitcoin? Well, good luck. You can sell it again if you like. But it's hard. And he will explain later how. On ramp and off ramp. What I want to conclude with is that I want to wrap up, and that means that if you fully understand what key management is, then you know exactly that it's about your own identity, and you control that with keys. And I gave you already a few tips, which I want to repeat. Yeah, the words are coming more difficult now. You need a cold store. You need, of course, good passwords, which we've got to say, good passwords. You could need a two-factor authentication. You could also use, let's say again. Good seed management, yeah, that was it. Okay, your seed backup, that's where we ended up. So your seed backup is normally done by 3-2-1 rule. And that means that you have 3 copies on 2 different physical devices stored in at least 1 other location, just in case of fire. Right? That's a clear rule, 3-2-1. So if you see some people writing, others not. Tomorrow morning, if you don't write, no worries. We have an over list that we send you later this night. And you can compare it to your own idea of what needs to be done in the over list.